What up, folks? You know we got to talk about this Maxo Cream featuring Megan Thee Stallion. Of course, Miami's Rolling Loud just popped off. We got to hit the hypes on that. And we got this goddamn album review from Styles P+. The CEO and founder of Incomparable is in the building on that boom bap. Let's get this shit popping. What up, what up, what up? Welcome to That Boom Bap. I'm your host, Gary Lee, also known as G Hawkins. Of course, you can find me anywhere online, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, Pornhub, at G Hawkins. That's G Hawkins with the Z. And I'm sitting with the lovely, the illustrious, the one and only Layla E. What up, Layla? How you living over there?
I love the gunshots. I feel like, you know, that's my alter ego.
Like you're going to shoot some shit up?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But what's up, everybody? This is Layla E. You can find me at Layla _E. E1 on IG and on Twitter, Layla _E. Please at me on Twitter because I need to do better at being more active on Twitter. And definitely check out our Facebook group and our IG at Boom Bap Official because we are motherfucking official.
Yes, indeed. I like that shit. And of course, as I mentioned in the monologue at the opening, we get blessed in this building every now and then. Every now and then, some of the greats walk through here. Ooh. And it makes the room rumble and shit. One of those greats happens to be sitting at the table right now, and he is the one, the only, the CEO and founder of Incomparable, Mr. Mario McCoy. What up, my G?
What's going on, good sir? I got claps. It's like Wheel of Fortune.
Yo, it's real shit.
I appreciate that.
We're setting the stage for excellence.
That's what we do, man. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I appreciate you having me back, you know?
We appreciate you being
all
on,
love,
bro.
All love.
It's a blessing to have you here,
yes,
man.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Every goddamn
Let's go.
Indeed. And we got a full-ass show, folks.
Oh,
so make sure y'all
God.
Are tied to us. Of course, we want to say what's up to our Facebook livers. We appreciate the support, the love. Make sure y'all get that full episode. We appreciate our YouTube live people. We appreciate that shit. And our IGTV folks. We love y'all. We support y'all. Make sure y'all are getting this entire episode and y'all are subscribing to this shit. But, Layla, I mean, hey. I've been rocking to some hot shit lately, including some stuff we're going to talk about later on. But okay. Ladies first, though.
Ladies
what you
first.
Been jamming to? Ladies what's going on? What's in your deck, your tape deck
you know
right
what?
Now?
You know what? It's really funny that I'm in this weird age. Well, okay, so I had a friend come down from New York, and I felt the need to showcase Houston's talent. Mm-hmm. And I completely forgot about one of my favorite songs from Charlie Boy, Bumper Grill. So I've been on like some straight H-Town stuff, some Big Mo, some Big Hawk, a whole bunch of Charlie Boy, Chamillionaire mixtape. So I've like been on the H-Town grind all month long. Mm-hmm. And I'm so super excited because that plays into something that we're going to discuss a little later,
okay.
too.
Okay. Well, yeah. Ain't nothing wrong with a little H-Town phone.
Yeah,
it's so funny because in the morning times, I'll hear Sway in the Morning.
Yeah.
LaKiki was up there.
Mm. What?
And he kicked a freestyle on Sway in the Morning, and it's a good 3-4 minutes. And
so
it's
H-Town, ain't
it's so Houston. And this shit is hard as fuck.
Yeah.
And you hear them, it's like these ebbs and flows. It's this flow, it's this roller coaster.
Yeah.
Because they're expecting him to stop, and then he keeps going.
Going, yes. Right.
He just keeps riding it.
Oh,
and
man.
It's phenomenal, man. What about you, Mario? What you rocking right now?
You know what? I'm messing with a lot of chinks.
Okay.
Legends never die.
Hmm. Okay.
What else am I rocking with? I'm rocking with it's a couple joints off that Styles P that we gonna get to.
Okay.
That I'm really digging.
So I like that.
We got a couple joints, man. We got a couple joints in the tape deck. Word to the Walkmans.
Come on. Hey, man. shout out to the great tapes, the Maxos,
truth,
man.
Oh, my God.
Shout out to DJ Screw, RIP.
Yes.
And for me, I'm actually rocking some this new cat. You know, I stay in that mellow vibe flow.
Yes,
like, that's
do.
My shit.
You always chill.
That's my vibe, right? That's my bag. Mm. So something specifically, and I've been playing around with this name and this new segment I'm going to introduce. It was
uh-oh.
Rhythm and Rap, but I think I want to do... What did I say? Mellow, I'm gonna get the shit right, but there's some segment title that I want that really embodies or encompasses how I feel about this mellow or this melodic flow.
Sounds like good alliteration.
Yeah, exactly. Right?
I got you.
So I want to be able to bring that shit to life. And there's an artist that's currently living in that, and his name is like Elhae, E-L-H-A-E. So he has this. He borderlines Drake a little bit, which may not be a bad thing financially. And in today's culture, it seems like you can be synonymous with your vocal tones and your cadence and flow and be successful.
You can piggyback. You can piggyback.
Yeah, whereas that shit was frowned upon in the 80s and the fucking 90s, walking into the 90s. Yeah. So this is cat. I'm vibing with him right now and a couple other people, but I'm in that flow so mellow. I like that. That flow so mellow mode that I'm in.
You might have came up with it on accident.
That flow so
mellow. You know what this reminds me of, though?
It reminds you of.
You're lucky I don't know the episode number, but Mr. I Like to Be So Mellow didn't give Little Sims that high of a damn score for the album review.
I don't understand why you keep going back to that.
One of my favorite episodes.
I guess so.
Yeah.
But whatever it is.
Yeah.
We'll
check out Little Sims Gray Area.
Okay.
And
do
it
that.
Was an episode like 6 episodes ago. Yeah. He was swimming, apparently.
Swimming
in the rice.
Oh, man.
Let's back on that shit. But let's move forward through this shit and let's hop on the track of the week.
Scope.
Oh, my God.
So this week's track of the week. It's from my main man, our $1.5 million man, Maxo Cream, featuring Megan Thee Stallion.
He got paid.
She live. Let's let this shit rock out for a minute. We hit Onyx, she hit Magic on Monday, G5, V-Live, she live and making money. I need a baby with some money, big diamonds and riding foreign, Gucci purse, I pack his pistol, these bitches can't get this issue. He a boss, I mean, just like Nino. You know what's funny? It's not necessarily for me, but it's in a space that is trending right now that they're going to be able to monetize from a stream perspective. I was watching this article on Genius, or this video. I don't know if it's a podcast that they have, but YouTube on Genius, and they were talking to Static Selecta and to Illmind, and they were talking about producers being paid via stream. So I got a better understanding of the streaming game, and I can see how something like this could make somebody a lot of money simply by being a hit trend of today and getting 30, 40 million streams easily. So I salute Maxo, and I'm always ride for Houstonians.
Right.
Always.
Right.
Not my vibe, but goddamn it, push that shit. Do what you do.
I get it. I mean, what I've noticed as far as I feel like I was cutting you off for like 2 seconds, and I'm sorry, I'm gonna be quick. What I've noticed regarding the streaming joints you brought up, I saw an article online where it talked about if you're a producer or if you're a rapper, if you get like a 33-33-33 split, if you stream, if your song is streamed 3 or 4 million times, you only get paid underneath $100.
People
try and boycott that and switch that whole format around. So it really depends. You know, Tidal, you get paid the most.
Yeah.
But, you know, all the other ones, like, you know, your YouTubes, your all of them, Apple Music, all of that.
Yeah.
It's bad.
Yeah, the numbers are horrible. There's a post that we'll put up on our social media platforms. There's a post that shows you what those stream numbers look like. This is your shit, though. I can see that you done flipped your hair.
You did
like,
not.
This is your shit.
Let it
well,
not.
I was going to play off what he said. Like J. Cole said on a lot, you know, that's how people get their streams, is by getting plays with machines. Like, I mean, that's the new trend. But yes, I'm super excited. I had to have this for the track of the week. The reason being is Maxo Cream is from the SWAT. Uh-huh. And we got Megan Thee Stallion. You know, she's from the H. Both of them have been in the news lately for she hit the top 100 Billboard for the first time. I think she's about to sign major if she hasn't already and we don't know about it. And Maxo, he just signed a major deal. And Maxo is one of my favorite. Yes, he was in my top 10 last year for one of my favorite albums of the year.
I
feel like Maxo Cream is one of the best in the game, period, point blank. Fight me. So well, this song. Well,
hold
is
on
amazing.
To that. Hold on to that. Because I want to get back to that shit. But Facebook, IGTV, we can't give you all of the stuff. You got to subscribe to get the rest of this. Mm-hmm. So make sure you head over to our YouTube page, the That Boom Bap Official Podcast. Make sure you hit us up on That Boom Bap, or excuse me, Boom Bap Official across all social media platforms. And of course, hit us on Spotify, iTunes, Google Play, all those platforms. Facebook, IGTV. We'll see y'all later. We got album reviews. We got all kind of shit to talk about right here on That Boom Bap.
Tell your friends about us.
We still got you here.
We got you. So getting back to the shit, because I want to make sure we got that for them. Mm-hmm. Keep this shit popping. Maxo Cream, 1.5 mil, Megan Thee Stallion. I mean, this may become a Houston anthem right now. What you thinking?
I think it's definitely a great way to break in the summer. I think this song is popping. It shows both of their personalities. This track of the week, play it again and again and again, because she plays really, I think Maxo is one of the best in the game, period, with cadence.
Yeah.
If you're a true fan of Maxo, you listen to his mixtapes and everything that he puts out, he's always playing with the beat. He's one of those rappers that actually listens to the beat, Nas, take notes, and he decides to make his flow go with that beat. And so you can tell that Meg basically took those notes, and they played very well together on that track. And so for me, I'm excited. This is bringing in the summer, and I'm ready for Houston to be on top of his game, because I'm expecting Toby to drop something soon too that's going to blow everybody's mind commercially speaking.
Mm, this is a great choice, Layla. Real rap. And I'm be honest.
Remember this moment, Mike.
Because this is you're spot on. Like, this welcomes in the summertime vibe.
Yeah.
Easily. Like I said, not my cup of tea, but I can respect it for what it is.
Yeah.
And it's a smart ass move right now.
Yep. Very definitely. Smart. H-Town all day. Yes. Yes, all month indeed. For me, apparently.
Obviously. Shit. So, being that we got someone special here at the table,
yes.
Squad. You know, being that we've got a fellow entrepreneur on the microphone, we definitely got to talk to you, my G.
Because
when I saw these beautiful ass timepieces come across my timeline,
true.
I'm like, what the? Who the? First, I had to say, okay, how do I put? Okay, there's some clever shit. Incomparable.
Yes, sir.
I had to figure out what the hell is going on. Then when I found out you were behind it, I was that much more intrigued. Let's talk about this shit. What's going on with you?
Please talk about it.
How'd you bring Incomparable to life? What was that passion, mission, and goal?
Passion, mission, and goal is I love watches ever since I was yay high.
Okay.
Like, my mom back in Milwaukee will always have a dope timepiece on. She always told me it's man law to never leave the house without a watch on.
Very true.
And I told her when I was like 11 to 12 years old, you know, one day I'm going to make my own watch company and I'm going to make you a joint.
Aww.
And Miracle, one of the newest releases we have on Incomparable.com. Y'all check that out. NCMPRBL.com. You already know what it is and how I go. That watch is dedicated to her. And that watch is out
very
right
nice,
now. So being able to take that opportunity and knowing it's not too many black millennials making watches for that particular demographic. Mm-hmm. You know, you saw that space and that opportunity, and you know, I met my passion, mm-hmm. met the opportunity, fuse it all together.
I like that, man.
Appreciate it, man.
And here's the beauty of this, man.
He's creative.
I never knew that this was sitting in your spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So to watch you bring, no pun intended,
all good.
To watch you bring this to life. I know.
I can't stand you.
it's powerful.
Cool. Appreciate it.
It's powerful, man, because a lot of times people sit on their dreams.
Right.
And they don't allow themselves to manifest them. Mm-hmm. Talk about some of the trials and tribulations in getting this off the ground.
It's so many. Financial.
Yeah.
And like you said, like, it really wasn't something where I'm a firm believer in moves before announcements. I always mm-hmm. had that, you know, just an internal conversation with the homies, just in general. It's one of my set principles, you know. So when I thought about it, I said, like, when would be a good time to bring this out? Okay, now it's a good flow of black businesses being able to support other people, and it's coming across tenfold. So you see, as far as like black people spending money, I believe the money circulates within a dollar like every like 6 minutes or like 6 hours. That's the longest we keep money or something like that. So obviously it's the lowest between Asians, white people, Puerto Ricans, et cetera, et cetera. So how can we fuse that market? I see that Rolexes and all of the other big name companies, the Fossils, the Tag Heuers, and you see those individuals and other companies and conglomerates making all this money.
Yeah.
And it only costs you about $30, $40 max to make that watch that you probably paid 5 or 6 G's for. Mm. So once I got to see the market, once I got to see, okay, This is the difference between a normal glass watch and mineral hard Lex. This is what makes Rolex not tick. This is what makes this particular band on this watch super dope. Mm-hmm. So you go to politics with folks in China, you know, you get them all made by the big boys, and they tell me, okay, well, we make these brands. Like, we make XYZ. I'm like, you mean to tell me that once incomparable comes into fruition, this same band that I have on right now is made by the same people that make Rolex for 70% cheaper of the cost? So now I'm able to play around with being direct to consumer. Now I'm able to look at, what do I want my price bracket to be? Sure. As far as, you know, my different mesh bands, my different faces, the different features within the watch, the different glasses within the watch, the different bands, all of that stuff that make the quality watch, the quality, the water resistance, you know, all of that, the Japanese, all the boring shit that people don't really care about. Decide, okay, this is what makes this, how this looks.
Yeah.
And how can I bring this out to the public? One was, are people going to take me seriously? Like, I'm a black man, I'm tatted up. Obviously, I come from the hip-hop culture. Mm-hmm. And fusing that hip-hop culture with, you know, the knowledge of the watches, you don't know any mainstream successful rapper that didn't talk about raise your rollies in the sky, you know, high to high, keep your hands high, like Big, Jay, all of that. And how come we can't have a black face in that market to disrupt it? That's why one of my mantras on the website is, you know, designed in Houston, disrupting the world.
Mm. So, I like
that's
that,
really
man.
Good. Now, I remember early on last year, you were kind of, you know, being generous and sharing your thought and your mind frame. Mm. And I remember one of your first designs compared to what you have now. Mm. What has evolved in the process of having the actual designs that you have now?
See, she brought that up. Y'all want y'all gifts now?
We got gifts?
Y'all got gifts.
Oh, well, shit.
What? I got
put them on the table. Put them on the table.
Okay.
First off, you know.
Oprah?
Layla, we have had many of discussions regarding my particular brand, the growth of my particular brand, how I want my brand to look like for Incomparable. So I have to say thank you.
Oh, of course.
And this particular watch right here is not released yet, so that's gonna be for you.
Oh shit! An exclusive.
Feel free. Feel free.
We got Incomparable.
An exclusive.
Exclusive. Okay. Oh, I like the face already.
That right there is Rain, ceramic band.
Oh wow!
Real diamonds on the inside.
That's very
nice. Whoa, this white is super nice.
That is dope as hell.
Wait a minute. Yeah, look at that.
That is a dope watch.
I wish I had my nails done. I look like a QVC
model.
I
can't stand you.
Oh, my God.
That's very nice.
No, and it's in the front and the back. Mm-hmm. And, I love this.
I see what I'm getting my mom
for
her birthday.
I'm about to get emotional.
That's a gorgeous-ass watch.
No, I'm about to get emotional because I know how. Oh, my God. I'm so proud of you. Look at. I can't.
I'm
going to
throw some shade.
But look at this. This isn't cheap.
At all.
No.
At all.
I wouldn't expect it.
At all.
This, man.
Look at this. You don't have watches that come like this.
It's incomparable.
Has everything on the back.
Mm-hmm.
Butterfly clasp. Okay, tell
claps.
Us more as
The butterfly clasp at the bottom, it folds in. I can't stand you like a Wheel of Fortune model, like Vanna White. It folds in and it makes sure that everything is comfortable within the links and whatnot. So it fits good on the wrist.
Wait.
It makes it real comfortable.
Back down. So wait, show.
Yeah, no, that's fire.
How
though.
You want that to look? So with this particular clasp right here, it goes bow and bow.
Oh wow! So you can't like lose it or
at all.
Oh my God!
So you don't lose it at all. It's a complete day and date file dial on there as well. You know, it's a real diamonds on the inside.
Mario, this is really like even seeing your first design compared to now. Mm-hmm. Wow!
Appreciate it.
Wow! I want to see yours now.
Man, yeah,
G Hawk off of me.
Yeah, G Hawk.
I want to get emotional.
Yeah, G Hawk. My boy is giving me a lot of game behind the scenes. You know, $1 million worth of game for free 99, and I want to make sure that I hit you off with a nice joint as well. This one is called Power. It will not be released until later on this year.
Man, we're getting exclusive. You,
so y'all got some exclusive joints, man. So that's coming from.
So just keep it a buck, man. Yes, I don't. It's so funny because I'm not accustomed to getting gifts.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to just say thank you so much, man.
Because
I never have expectations of anything from anyone because my father taught me to earn everything I get, man. So just thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Man, it comes to, man, let's show that.
The face in that. That's clean, bro.
I appreciate that, good brother.
Yo,
I appreciate
that's
that.
Clean.
I appreciate that.
Oh, my God.
You should hold that up.
QVC this up, baby.
That's all. That's all
my
black.
God.
Right there.
I did some studying on y'all wrists and got to see what y'all like to wear and all of that.
Man,
so yeah.
So you notice I'm usually naked, right?
I can't stand you.
I keep it dark on my wrists,
yes,
man.
Yes.
And I appreciate that, bro. And this is phenomenal.
And that's the one that you said you saw that you really liked, right?
It's very similar to the what is that, the Elite? That's on your
website. Similar to the Elite. Yep, similar to the Elite.
I love it.
And we didn't have that conversation prior to y'all.
We did not.
Like at all.
We had that conversation at all.
This is fire, bro.
I appreciate that,
man.
All love.
I'm gonna give you a real big hug afterwards.
I can't stand up. I'm just leave this out so I can look at it and smile every time I just look down.
All love,
man. That's fire.
Those are real chronographs. They all active right there too, and that's 100% stainless steel on an actual band. Yes. That's mineral glass and all that. But I did all that study and just looked in hip hop culture because Incomparable is birthed from hip hop.
So
as a rapper, you know, chasing history on iTunes right now, and being able to infiltrate the market and be like, what can I do as a black entrepreneur to have something that's going to, one, disrupt the market, and two, have like a family heirloom type of ordeal, you know, because I got an almost 2-year-old. I want to make sure that legacies live forever. That's the parent brand of the company. So being able to have that particular format and slowly build upon the brand. So every single dollar goes back into the brand, as you pointed out, with the first designs to, you know, now what we building into. So
indeed.
That's really it, man.
I live in being comparable. Mm-hmm. Come on.
And you know, once you look at the wrist, you got to make sure you had that piece of confidence when you wear it. You know, our main mantra is create over conform, you know, which is definitely what y'all do here at the Boom Bap, you know.
That's how it's supposed to be,
you
man. I keep going back to my father because he plays such an integral part in my life, man. I don't leave the house without a watch on.
See?
Easy proof, if I take my watch off right now, you will see
crease.
You will see the
tan line.
Yep.
You can see the
you got
tan
that
line,
crease.
I don't live without a watch.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it's important to me. So it's, man, salute to you, bro.
Appreciate it, man.
Salute to you.
And I appreciate y'all.
My future kids should be wearing Incomparable. They should be looking for that before they look for any other brand in the marketplace. That's how it should be.
Definitely so.
Sewing into ourselves first.
Definitely so.
Well, my best friend's birthday is next month. He has a huge watch collection.
Boom.
So
you know, Incomparable.com. Let's build.
Right.
Yep.
So again, tell us where everyone can find you.
Yes, Incomparable.com. Incomparable.com. That's NCMPRBL.com. You can find us on all social media platforms at B Incomparable. That's BENCMPRBL. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube. We got a YouTube channel too. Where I get my Derek Jackson on in the car. Whenever I drop my little one off at daycare, I make my little videos and build with y'all. So you know,
that.
Being
I like
able to
how
build
the,
that way.
The code is Dear Mama.
I had an online sale for Mother's Day, and you know, the code was Dear Mama.
That's so dope.
Yeah,
we
stay connected to the culture, man. We stay connected
indeed.
To the culture.
R.I.P.
Well, thank you so much.
Yes,
no problem.
Sir.
No problem.
Yes,
you know,
sir.
That's just what y'all do for the culture, man. You know, y'all make a big impact in Houston and beyond. So had to make sure I got
and look at G
gifts.
Like, this is how serious the packaging is. He's still unraveling.
It took some time because it was done right.
Yes,
it was packaged properly.
Packaged perfect. Oh, I still have. Oh, I haven't taken all mine.
Yeah,
off.
Yeah. You got the full plastic
like
on
that,
there.
Actually.
You got the full.
Yeah.
Okay, that
just
works too.
For a little while.
I got you.
Oh, my God. Well, thank you for that.
Yeah, no problem.
We appreciate that Oprah moment.
We
gotta start inviting some people that you know, like owner of Audi and all of that stuff.
Audi ower.
Yeah, that's what I'm
like,
saying.
Like, bring me some keys.
Tesla,
drop
you know,
the e-tron up here,
you know,
so we can rock it.
I done started a problem.
You just started a big problem because you the first.
I can't.
But it's about the big timers, right? We're sitting with a big timer, and there's some big time things popping, especially over in Miami.
Oh,
right, Layla? We're Rolling Loud last week.
So I feel like Rolling Loud is the setup for all rappers. Okay, so let me give y'all a little background of what was going on with Rolling Loud. So it's one of the biggest hip-hop music festivals that we have. Day one, all of a sudden, somebody screamed active shooter. There was an active shooter supposedly around. Everybody starts running. You know what that causes?
Mm-hmm.
Panic, people getting hurt, people falling, everything. Police came out with helicopters.
Oh,
it was crazy. And for someone who is in charge of an event, this is major. And one thing you don't tell people when they're panicking is keep calm. You don't do that. Someone got on the main stage and was telling everyone to keep calm. People didn't know what to do. So that unfortunately pushed back a lot of the artist's time. Day two, They had a similar situation. Day three, it rained for a few hours. Wow. Not only that, but a lot of artists were going over their time by like an hour or two. Yes. Oh, it was 45 to an hour and a half that artists were going over on their time slot. So you know what that means. Artist shows were getting pushed back. Some people were canceling. Mm-hmm. One of the major people that was one of the headliners was Lil Wayne. When he got there, he realized that the police were doing, you know, checks. Mm-hmm. And we all know what that means. That's a definite setup, you know. So he canceled his show, and he actually released something on his Twitter. And let me go ahead and read that for y'all. He told his fans, to all my fans who came to see me at Rolling Loud, I'm sorry, but I won't be performing. The festival police, not Rolling Loud, made it mandatory that I had to be policed and checked to get on the stadium grounds. I do not and will never settle for being policed to do my job and give you guys a great show. I will be at Story tonight for the after party, and then you could catch me on tour with my bros, Blink-182. So, amongst other things, I wanted to tap on that a little bit, but do you think that it is wise for artists to stop doing shows based off of policing?
I'll let you tackle that.
Yeah, I would say so. Only reason is because nowadays artists have the platform to speak immediately as to why they couldn't. You know, 15 years ago, you don't have that Twitter, Facebook platform to say why, and now that leaves your fans pissed, right? So at least now you have fans mm-hmm. that can aim to see the point.
Right.
You know, like you said, you know, it looked like a setup. Like, why would you pay me? Because you have to pay me up front before I come to this show. So if you're going to pay me, I signed a contract, all of that good stuff. You know, you look at the fine print. If I know that I'm going to get policed and checked at this show, I'm going to be prepared for that before I get there.
Yeah.
If I'm going to get surprised, we good. That's something I should have known about. Especially if I'm a headlining act. Like, yeah. You know, I'm not Lil Twist. I'm Lil Wayne. You know, I'm
but this
not
has happened to him before in the exactly, past. I mean, exactly. With his tour bus and everything.
Exactly.
What about you, Gene?
So I think I sit on I understand mm-hmm. that perspective. I think I sit on the other side mm-hmm. of it, though. If you have been paid and you're now contractually obligated, mm-hmm. give the fans what they want. Mm-hmm. And if it means that you may need to, it's complicated.
It's a slippery slope.
It is, because I'm not a fan of being police, because right. obviously, you know, where the police come from and the whole criminal, you know, justice mm-hmm. system situation, the complex that what has been built on the backs of African Americans,
mm-hmm. yeah.
is crazy. Mm-hmm. But from a fan's perspective,
right.
I want to see Wayne.
Right.
But I don't want him to compromise himself, and nor do I think he should be incomparable in regard to what he's doing. So it's complicated. Mm-hmm. Like, damn, take the weed out, put it back on the bus, get searched, give the crowd what they want. That's me assuming.
Right.
But I can understand the premise of, I don't want to be searched when I'm trying to go do my job.
Right.
I should be able to walk to this stage and perform. What's the need to search me as if I'm going to do something in the midst of my business
right.
to lose my contract,
right.
lose
right.
this $100,000 I've been paid right. to deliver to this audience?
I'm glad you brought up the contract piece. Do you think that should have been put into the
possibility? Of course.
Because then he would have been like, okay.
Yeah, maybe. And here's the thing. It may have been there. The question then becomes, if it was there, mm-hmm. did his people look at that and make him aware?
Because
it may have already been in there. And I'm a person doing Rolling Loud, and I'm looking at the flyer right now, and for those that are watching this, we've got the flyer up for our people watching this in YouTube or watching this via video on iTunes. There's over 100-plus people. I mean, it's mind-blowing how many artists are at Rolling Loud during this weekend. I'm sure
that's
it's going to continue.
That's huge,
if not the biggest in the country. Mm-hmm. With that being said, whoever's putting this on, I'm sure they've got some verbiage or jargon mm-hmm. in the contractual agreements that talk about the responsibility and the things that are happening.
Right.
I don't know how they, being that they're doing things at this level, how they would miss putting that in the contract.
Right.
The question becomes, did that information get to Wayne beforehand? Maybe not.
You think it's about 75 artists on that list. You think all of them got checked?
Nope.
Well, I mean, and at the end of the day, it can be looked at as two things. First of all, it's the safety of the festival.
True.
Right? Mm-hmm. Secondly, you kind of have to have a level of professionalism when you go to certain events. And I feel like, yeah, we know a lot of rappers, stereotyping, have weed, probably got some guns on them. And it's not to actually murder somebody. It's for their protection because people are after them. Right. I mean, unfortunately, there was a death that weekend with another rapper, which I'll talk about shortly. But one person that wasn't lucky that weekend that got caught up was Kodak Black. He's been a hot topic for the past couple of weeks with us, right? So he was actually arrested, and this is actually for something that you wouldn't think of. He basically, and the thing is if he gets convicted, this is 10 years, and this is a separate case amongst all the other cases that he's currently fighting for. Now, according to court documents obtained by XXL, he can face up to 10 years in prison for allegedly lying on his application to receive a firearm. It's not that serious, but that's exactly what. I mean, it's not that serious that you have to lie to obtain a firearm.
But you're going to get caught. Like, you.
I mean, why would he do that?
You're going to get caught. Like, how can you think that you're going to get away with lying on an application to receive something that you already have to go through red tape to get to anyway?
I have no idea. He needs guidance. I think J. Cole also said that on Middle Child. Like, Kodak Black needs that guidance, like, for real. And he could also receive a $250,000 fine and 3 years of supervised release.
That's what he get for Sandy Colden and Tupac.
You know, that's what he get for saying a lot of things. And also, unfortunately, there's not too many details going on, but Chicago rapper AAB Hella Bands was shot and killed that weekend. And he wasn't at the festival, so let's just make that clear. But a lot of bad things have been going on this weekend. The baby threw out fake weed to the audience, which I don't even understand why, because some of them kids probably really going to try to smoke that. Isn't that K2 stuff when the first face zombie eater thing came out like 10 years ago was in Miami? Like, I don't know what they doing, yo. But all in all, do y'all attend music festivals to this magnitude?
Hell no.
Mm-mm.
No? It's too much.
Mm-hmm.
It's too much standing. It's too many people. It's not conducive to truly enjoy the essence of hip hop, in my perspective. I know some people who love festivals.
I can't do festivals.
I won't. I'd rather go see that artist in an arena somewhere where I've got the convenience of bathrooms right when I want them, food if I need it. I mean, there's a. Maybe I'm just a bougie artist enjoyer. I don't fucking know. No, I can't call it.
That's your experience. Yeah. No, that's not bougie at all. Like, if you go to like this, the stand, obviously it's standing room only, and you know you can't go to the bathroom. You can't go get something to eat. Somebody will box you if you try to get past them.
Yeah,
everybody drunk. You step on somebody's shoes the wrong way. Fake pistols and all.
I mean,
you never know.
Even in Austin, like I could do South By, but I really never did ACL because I'm just like I'm not that kind of person.
Right.
And speaking of, you know, people getting sentences and everything, you actually had someone that is receiving a big sentence.
One of the C-minus list rappers. Flow. No.
Wow.
This man, you got two life sentences for killing two brothers.
That's
it's
crazy.
Disrespect. Like he used to be on Young Money, probably one of the weed carriers of Young Money, because I've never heard none of his music on Young Money.
Yeah,
but that's one of the casualties of one not being rich enough to have a dope lawyer.
Yeah.
You know, you two life sentences for allegedly killing two brothers, and you know, you read the article, you know, the he had people that was with him testifying against him.
His own mother.
His own mama did. Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So you know that's curtains. You know, and you know the brother's mom, you know, blatantly told them, like, you know, that obviously you weren't loved because you knew that my boys were loved and you killed them anyway. And I'm like,
oh, and she said, I'm happy enough that you were stupid enough to get caught. And because I think he dropped his cell phone.
He left the cell phone.
Sloppy
on
murderer.
Sloppy.
Yeah. But
super
it's like,
sloppy.
And this was all over him thinking that one of the brothers or both of the brothers stole $8,000 worth of stuff from him. So you're telling me that both of those brothers' lives was worth $8,000? No, your life was worth $8,000 because your life and your afterlife is in jail right now.
Man.
Like, that's ridiculous. I don't even know who this kid is. Like, is his music on SoundCloud or something?
I don't know.
He probably did some ad libs on like the Carter 2 or something.
Yeah.
You know. Oh my God.
Exactly.
And you know what? You're from Milwaukee, right?
Born and raised.
Yeah. So Milwaukee.
Bucks and five.
Well, funny that you said that, because Milwaukee radio station out there is actually banning all Drake music until after the NBA finals.
That's B100.
That is petty.
That's B100.
Is that petty? I mean.
That's B100. You know, that's the crib. That's the crib.
When I saw it on the runner show, I was like, why is this important? Then it hit me that they're playing Toronto. And I'm like, oh, that is petty as shit.
Oh, my God. You had a Layla moment.
The Drake curse is real, though. Whatever team Drake really fuck with, they lose.
Yeah.
Like, they lose. Like, they'll get to a certain point, like Kentucky, then Alabama. Like, they lose, you know? So, we're not going to play Drake music at the crib.
On a scale of 1 through 10 on petty, what do you give this radio station?
That's a 20.
I would give that definitely an 18, 19. Because I have an idea. Milwaukee is small enough to where you know people that work at the radio station. So, like, you have an idea as to who recommended it. And I'm not going to say no names. But you know what you did, and that shit was kind of fly.
I think it's hilarious. I had to put that on there. Because I'm like, look at your people at it again. They always doing something for a small town.
The crib is lit back in Milwaukee. The crib is lit right now. Y'all stay safe at the crib now.
Man, look. Man. Shout out to Milwaukee. But what's our dude name? Giannis? Giannis?
Oh, yeah, the Greek freak. Hi, Greek how are you?
I can't stand you. He wasn't always that buff pause.
Like, it don't matter. I like him. So,
the boy's out there grinding, man.
I like him for him.
He get a three ball. It's over.
Yeah, and cornrows don't lie. Kawhi on that Toronto. Yeah,
come on, bro.
That boy is doing his thing, man.
Look, I was at Alley Cat a couple of weeks ago, and I was watching the game, and I was like, doesn't he play for the Spurs? I had no idea that he got traded. Yeah,
And then took the team to the Western Conference Finals.
I mean, he's a great player.
He is.
Shout out to my Rockets. Unfortunately, we didn't pass this last one. It's always Golden State.
I don't hate the Warriors, but I hate the fact they got like winner's fatigue, and like Houston's supposed to be built to beat Golden State, and they talked all that shit during the year, from the owner to the whole run it back marketing campaign, and you know how that goes. Yeah. You make a big ass billboard on 45 talking about running back, and you get the team, and you lose in six.
Yeah,
you lose in Houston.
You know what we always say every year. Always next year. Shout out to my Rockets. Yes. Man,
we respect your loyalty.
For real.
Man.
But speaking of what's next, it's time for our album review. So,
always thought that was dope.
That shit is fire, y'all. That shit gets me so hyped. Yeah. But what also gets me hype is Styles P.
Yeah.
The Ghost is real. SP the GOAT, Ghost of all time. He's dropped some new heat for us. Rock with us as we rock with you. Styles P. Let's get this shit popping.
Vinny Idol, nigga.
You know I like
that. Couple down in the sweats. Nice watch, nice coupe. Lounge on the set. You ain't built for the shit. You ain't allowed in the set. Told my mom I'm a G, and I'm proud of the shit. I'm a G. My mentality was warped. 20 years later, my mentality is sauce. Whole crew drip a test, us, you a corpse. Nobody wanna die, but somebody wanna kill anybody but you.
I wish we could let it play all the way. I know, right? We ain't trying to get in trouble.
So here's my thing. Styles P. I feel like ever since he partnered, I'm gonna call it a partnership, he partnered with Rick Ross on BMF. Off of Rick Ross's Teflon Done album. Mm. At that moment, Styles, not that he awakened, but it felt like the world awakened to him. And he was like, oh, now y'all hear me? Let's go. And from that point on, it's been nothing but this linear projection, just up every year consistently, more and more content, better and better. And I'm always excited to get something from him. How do you feel about this transition from Styles P being behind Jada as part of, you know, the Locks and this D-Block family to who he is today?
You hit the nail on the head when you said consistency. If you go back all the way back to Gangsta and the Gentleman, he had that spark, I get, with Swiss, I throw gone.
Yeah, no.
But you saw that little drop off a little bit, but when you talk key moment, the BMF moment. But so now you look at BMF and you see the other projects that he has. He's able to open his eyes and see, okay, now I can collaborate dope with a Talib Kweli. I can
seven.
Right. Like I can collaborate dope with any other DJ and really go in their lane. Yeah. And not necessarily bring too much YO with me, but I'm gonna give the fans what they want. And that consistency, that constant ascension. And one thing that's dope about Styles being able to run neck and neck with Jada, he didn't have to compromise his style.
Because,
you know, Jada was always the punchline, super raspy voice, even though they sounded like niggas used to get them two mixed up. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you see that constant ascension to where he is today, and it's dope.
Yeah.
It's dope. And even Roc Nation put a battery in his back, too, with their partnership with the Locks, too. So it's all good.
I'm thoroughly impressed by, once again, the consistency.
That Dead Man record on there is crazy.
Yo.
With the A-Marie sample,
crazy. Yo.
For those of you that remember A-Marie, you're dope, you're awesome.
And shout out to Nino Man. I mean, Nino Man is a G. I remember when Styles brought him up, and I referenced Sway in the Morning because I've listened since the beginning of Sway in the Morning, and I remember being introduced to Nino Man. And so to have him on that Dead Man record and on What's Up Boy, it's like get him in, get him grinding, because he's sitting on something beautiful. Layla, how do you feel about this new Styles P record?
Well, this is what, his
shit.
11th studio shit. Album. Totally. He just dropped Dimebag last year, and he dropped Beloved, which was one of my favorites.
Top five.
With Dave
East.
Now, that album, I really, really thoroughly enjoyed.
That shit felt like bully rap.
Right. That was real East Coast at its finest. Shout out to Reem.
Bought a pair of Tim's to match Reem for that week. They were serious about this, okay? But my first listen wasn't the best listen. Mm-hmm. I think this is an album that you kind of have to put yourself in the mood. It's not something that you listen to at work when everybody annoying you.
Right.
Definitely not. You may come out with some gunshots or something like that, you know. But this album was more of a mellow album. It kind of plateaued for me.
Okay.
There were no valleys and peaks. It was just a cool album to vibe out to. So after about my 7th, 8th listen in, I started to appreciate it a little more. I'm not going to lie to you. You know how I am about my first listens versus my other listens.
Slow bake.
It definitely was. It was like the opening of Breaking Bad. Very slow.
Right.
I feel that for Styles P, first of all, we can't deny his lyrical capability of putting us in the zone and being able to see what he's rapping about. I definitely like a lot of the metaphors, and I wish I would have wrote down one of them that I had on here. But I like that he played the way that he plays with the beats as well. I think he could have had some better features. Is that fair to say? Or should I say he should have added additional features to a couple of his tracks? Because I feel like some of it was a little bit not up to speed. So let me see. Who did he have so far as his features?
Well, we talked about Nino Man.
Nino Man. He also had Jada.
Jada and Chris Streets. We had D-Block Europe. And then, of course, we got to mention Lil Fame. Now,
this is the what is this, the Professionals track?
Yeah.
But he was on the Professionals track.
Yeah. No, this is not Professionals yet. It's coming up. But
that's the record Lil Fame was on.
Yeah, the one that Lil Fame was on.
Yeah.
And something about Lil Fame's voice,
just MOP.
Yo.
Yeah, he's just all MOP.
It's like it is hip hop.
Yep.
It is.
So when you hear it, you're like, oh, this is just hip hop.
It's real gutter.
It feels iconic.
Yeah, real gutter, real tunnel, real East Coast in 2002, 2003, we should have released the album on Rockefeller.
Riding on the 1, 2, or the 3.
Oh, true.
Yeah, heading up to Harlem. Like, this is what I feel like when I'm listening to that album. That record specifically.
Well, I think that, I think what I was missing was I wanted him to have somebody that was fun on the record.
Mm.
And what I mean by fun, like, Dave East is fun when he jumps on the record with him, even though he's kind of mirroring a lot of what he's doing. But I wish it was somebody who probably wasn't up to his lyrical capability to play with him, because it just would have been a little bit more fun, because he did have some solid people as features.
But
so I need to retract my statement. I said that wrong. I wish he had more features that were not so much like him, right, so to speak. Definitely, I love Dead Man with Jada and Nino. That was one of my favorites. Out in the Jungle was really dope. I Ain't Shit, I think that's the one that I started liking, but I started getting annoyed by it. So the repetitive nature of that song annoyed me. So I had to skip that. But overall, Styles P's will never disappoint you. He is what can we call him? A legend?
A legend in his lane. I would say a legend in his lane. Really, really, as a if we continue to, you know, critique the project, it's more so he knew his lane and he knew his vision for this project. It's like if he would have had like that fun record on there, it would have been like
it would have threw off the whole
Yeah, like too. What was that fun record off the Blueprint? Not Ola Ovito, Jigga That Nigga. That's the only record off the Blueprint. Jigga, nigga, that nigga, jigga. Like, why are you standing next to You Don't Know? No, why are you standing? Like, so one of those. It's like, so when I'm listening to the album, it took me a few listens to digest it too, but I knew what to expect from Styles. Mm-hmm. Push the Line was dope, but I'm like, Sheik, why you rapping off beat? Come on, bro. No, you 46. What's good, bro? Like,
hey. Don't be calling out names.
I love Sheik.
I mean, ages. Let's not do that.
Hey, I'm just saying, you know it.
But
love
we expect
Sheik.
More.
Yeah. Well, you know, he didn't have anybody like you talked about. He didn't have anybody to really push the envelope to make him dope. Like if you remember Hawk Sheen, too late. Shootouts off Kiss of Death. You knew they was going bar for bar. Like that's like Brooklyn's finest Jay and Big. Yeah. He didn't have that feel on that album. Yeah. So I get what you mean.
Yeah. But I will say production was pretty solid. I mean everything went together. I know on that Boom Bap Official, follow us. We tend to talk a lot about arrangements because we like how an album starts off and how it ends. Obviously, I said I hated the way that it ended. For y'all, do y'all think that was a great intro to start out with his Push the Line featuring the Whispers?
It's to me, it sounded like it was 12 records thrown together.
Really?
Not necessarily. Mm-hmm. Sonically, it was great, like you said, the arrangement, because the tempo, the pace, all that's dope. Yeah, but it didn't really give me, like, encapsulating the title of Ghost of All Time. Like, what is that within these records?
Right.
So, what you think, Hawk?
You know, I agree with everything that's been said, and I stand firm with that. I think y'all are spot on with this shit. Going back to what you mentioned earlier, Layla, and same thing with you. I felt like it was a very slow digestion, a very long cook, because when I first heard it, I was like, damn, nothing stands out. And then it was like, oh, wait a minute, there's something. And then after a couple of more listens, like, oh, there's something. Like, so it took a moment for things to fall into line for me. And it is very hodgepodge-ish, like it's just there.
Right.
And it kind of works because it's just there, I guess, because it's there's a very even tempo and pace and the cadence outside of Sheik Luch. Everybody's right in the pockets where they need to be. But for me, that makes the impact of the album kind of, it lessens it a little. Like, it doesn't do anything. It's like, I know you can rap, I know you write well, I know you will continue to put out music, and I appreciate how you're growing as an artist, but there's no impact in this, right? And there's nothing that I'm pulling out of this that is definitely going to heat up the summer for me, per se. Out of the Jungle is a standout track, as you mentioned. I'm a big fan of Out of Jungle. I'm such a big fan that I want to speak to those who are tuned in right now.
Uh-oh.
Some of the lyrics from Out of the Jungle. Specifically, there's a part where he says, Kitsy Ghost ain't Ye ain't Cuddy, referencing Kitsy Ghost, the Ye Cuddy album collaboration. But the 45's my buddy for all of the side drama. Fucking with the scariest, you can Hail Mary. I'm probably plotting like Tyron. I'm plotting Lannister. And when I hear the beat behind it, like I want to become Styles when I say the shit, right? And I'm not him. They gonna need a janitor. There's matter on the banister. He leaving. He ain't have the stamina. Hammer in the canister. It was a moment in this shit where I just felt like he was just exploding in his bars. When somebody, I think the proper term is spaz the fuck out. Like, that's a spaz out moment, especially being the fact that we're right in the midst of the season finale, the series finale of Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
So he's talking about shit, and I'm literally like, goddamn, Tyrion was plotting and shit. Like, it's so timely.
Oh, he's
and
he a big
just,
fan.
He's such in this cadence, it just feels perfect. One, this to me was that standout track,
okay.
Out of the Jungle, man. That shit was fire. Verse 2 just annihilated this shit.
You must be rating this album pretty high.
I'm not.
Because, I love surprises here at that boom back.
Because of what I mentioned. So if I had to go to it, right?
What happened to the sandwich method?
I know, right? I know, right? That shit was out the window. But to roll this shit back around, of these 12 tracks.
12. Yeah.
Four of those I'm with. I rock with about four of them, right? That really speak to me where I'm like, okay, I get excited when I hear this now versus the other ones I can probably miss that.
Yeah.
Bars are always on point, right? Arrangement, it's there, it's kind of hodgepodges, whatever. Productions, it's on par. It's what I would expect. I don't feel like it's lackadaisical, but I don't feel like it's spectacular.
Right.
Playback value, because there's so many skips, I'm like, and like I mentioned the impact earlier, the impact's just not there. So for me, it's probably like a 5 out of 12.
Okay, you get on my dog on nerves. He has rating systems that don't make sense to nobody but him. He'll have, this is a 5 out of 8, this is an 8 out of 15,
but it got 12 joints on it.
And 5 out of 12.
Oh, wait. Are all your ratings based off the tracks on the album?
So the four tracks that I like, and then I use my BIPA method, and I give points based on BIPA. So I'm giving him the bars, and the everything else is pretty much all right.
No, but is your rating scale based off?
Part of.
Oh.
It's part of.
I feel like I just learned something new today.
Welcome.
I wish I had a little light bulb.
Welcome to that boom bap.
The more you know.
So, yeah. I'm going to go 5 out of 12 for me on this one.
Okay. All right.
Mario, how you feeling about this, man? Overall, project.
I'm going to say 4 out of 12.
Wow.
I'm going to say 4 out of 12. Dead Man saved it.
Okay.
Dead Man, same thing with you. I didn't like how it closed with I Ain't Shit.
Oh, my God.
And the thing goes with I Ain't Shit, this is how you know I'm a rapper. I Ain't Shit, the hook changes at the end of each verse. Mm-hmm. It's like, I Ain't Shit, you ain't shit, because he's talking about somebody else at the end of the third verse.
Yeah.
So I get the notice and stuff like that, and I'm like, why is the hook changing? Like, I'm already trying to catch up with all these different words, because the hook is like another like 4-bar sequence in itself. I'm like, I can't fuck with that. So, but Push the Line of intro is decent. But from, I know what to expect from Styles.
Yeah.
But like you said, I needed to have that impact there. I needed to have like those one or two joints. Remember, we used to listen to hip hop, y'all, and like number 11 was always the shit.
Number six too.
Like number Hard Knock Life Volume 2, Money Cash Hoes, number 6, number 11, DMX, No Love for Me. Like,
I love you so much for this random shit.
I love y'all
shit.
Too. But you know, you listen to those records, you want that feeling back. That's what it talks about, you know, with the impact. And that's what talks about, you know, with the beats and the overall flow. Like, I don't want to be like, all right, I know what I'm gonna expect from whoever, and then that's all I get.
Yeah.
Give me some dope shit so I can rock to it. Houston's big. I want to ride through the city and listen to your joint a couple times.
Traffic is long.
Traffic is disrespectful. So we talk about the playback value. I can listen to it twice and forget about it and not feel bad about it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, well,
and what about
that's
you,
all,
baby?
Folks. No, okay. Well, one thing I will say is that I was kind of like ready, because now, you know, I'm looking at the roster for the month and seeing what albums are dropping. And then I peep what Styles P wrote. He said, album drops at midnight. I really don't promote as much as I should, but if I say I'm dropping, you can bet your bottom dollar bars will be involved. So I was like, all right. He obviously stayed true to that. His bars definitely were there. For me, I look at how many I would put on my playlist. I would probably put 0, because my playlist is kind of different. This wouldn't fit in that pocket.
You got a lot of H-Town on your playlist right now.
Well, actually, you know what? I just lied. Okay, I have multiple playlists. I got the chill playlist.
Okay.
I got my H-Town playlist. And I have my regular going around playlist. And that doesn't fit me.
Either. That's three.
Yeah, I know. Sheesh. If I had a New York playlist, I probably have one joint on there. Now, as far as playback value, if I wanted to go back and listen to something, it's kind of there. But like Mario said, I'll probably, you know, I won't really be sad if I don't. And that's not because he's not great. And this doesn't take away from an artist right. when they do drop hot shit like he drops. It's just that we also need, like G said, that impact. And that was missing for me. I look at the arrangement of an album. I obviously look at bars, lyrics. And for me, out of 10, I would probably have to give this a 5 out of 10. And I feel so disrespectful.
That's the highest at the table.
Yeah, well, I give it a 5 out of 10 because, he's a lyricist. The bars are there. And I think it's really disrespectful for me to give someone like 21 Savage a higher rating.
You did, too.
And I did. And I really, really still like his album. It was because it was fun. And this album for me just stayed in one pocket. And it was just like, But that doesn't mean anything, Styles P. I want to interview you in person. We want to interview in person one day. No. You're still mad dope. But for me, this wasn't there for me.
Beloved was better.
Beloved was for sure better.
The 7 was way fucking
better. And I mean, this leads me to another question before we close out. Do you think that maybe he's dropping too much content at one time? Because he has been dropping a lot of hot fire.
So I'm actually glad you asked that question, which takes me back to something I mentioned earlier when we were talking Maxo Cream and we were talking about Megan The Stallion, right? This streaming game is real.
Serious.
And Chris Brown knows this shit. There's a couple other artists that know this shit. You can drop it. If you can, so streaming, it makes no sense to go back to the mixtape game and give the music away for free, even though that was simply marketing to bring people to your shows, right? Because that's where you make your real ass
money
at, right? Now here's the flip. Instead of me dropping 20 on a mixtape, I can drop 20 in a streaming service, and I'm going to get paid for those streams, right? And they may be, as you mentioned, Mario, sub pennies on the stream, because they are. Some of them are like 0.00147, and I think titles like 0.012 something, which is the highest, right? You're getting a fucking penny per stream, so you need to do millions to see some type of real decent revenue.
Yeah.
But if I drop 20 fucking songs, if I drop 40 songs, if the over the whole year I've dropped 120 tracks and I'm averaging 1 million plus streams per track, add that shit up. Like, the numbers don't fucking lie. They're making money on this stream game by dropping as much content as possible, hoping some of the shit hits the fan and blows because it's putting revenue back in their pockets.
So you're saying quantity over quality at this point.
Unfortunately, I think the game is headed there. And if you can hit, if you can have a hot ass track out of those 20, and you're not building great albums. Shout out to Sky Zoo. Shout out to some of the producers that get Smoke Dizza. You know, getting with people and shit like that. If you can drop a hot ass single and it blows the fuck up on stream, you're golden.
Yeah.
Versus having a beautiful ass, organized and arranged, sonically beautiful album.
Right.
That may never get over 1 million streams as a whole project. It's a sad situation, but you got to understand the game.
Yeah. I do like that we consider he's been out since 95, 96, right? He has that old man flow. What I mean by old man flow is not disrespectful. It's saying that he's not a rapper that keeps throwing in people's faces that you need to stick with us and look at all these other younger rappers.
Yeah.
And I like that he doesn't do that because it also puts him at that level of someone that you just got to respect. Mm-hmm. So shouts out to Styles P with The Ghost. What is it called? SP.
The Ghost of the Time
album. Dope. Definitely. We're going to close out the show. My name is Layla E. You can find me at Layla_E1 on IG as well as Twitter, Layla_E. And definitely give me some suggestions for international hip hop as well, because the segments start very soon. We got something in store for y'all.
Yes, they do. And I have to say once again, man, thank you so much to Mr. Mario McCoy,
he is
the CEO and founder
Hand claps.
My G, thank you for the beautiful timepieces. This is going to be loved by the ladies. We appreciate it. Everybody here is living incomparable right now on our wrists. We're doing it. Please let the people, whoever's listening to us, the sound of our voices, watching this right now, where can they find you, reach you, and pick up some of these beautiful pieces?
All love. Creative Conformance, the mantra, being comparable. That's everywhere. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube. That's BENCMPRBL. And you can find all watches on incomparable.com. That's NCMPRBL.com. Appreciate the love. Oh, man.
We appreciate you.
We appreciate you.
Shit, we popping boxes at the table.
Man,
not boxes.
I have to give gifts, man. No problem.
Thank you.
And of course, you can reach me anywhere online, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, at G Hawkins. That's G Hawkins with a Z. Hit us up, Boom Bap Official, across all social media platforms, and make sure you subscribe to the show on our YouTube channel. Just look for that Boom Bap Podcast. Official, because that's what we're doing. And of course, if we don't tell y'all this shit anywhere else, we gotta tell you here. Rap
minus
lies
equals
hip hop,
and that's that boom bap.
We'll see y'all next time. Peace.